Hello. Actually, I will try to be as short as possible and not so serious, and not just because of lack of time, but also just I'll try to be as much as possible concise, maybe, but quite enough provocative. I would like to talk about that the issue regarding Hegelian framework and how we're trying somehow to make a breakthrough and to free ourselves and to search for new solutions for new challenges and so on, but we still, in some sense, I think we still keep coming back to this framework. And but initially, I would like just to make a small reflection on what are we doing actually as scholars, scientists, intellectuals, philosophers, and I made very small analogy from my, let's say, experience. Yes, I made a sin, like long time ago I bought that book. Actually, it was a big fashion of that kind of books, you know, how to earn your first billion, how to become a successful businessman, how to become and so on. It was a huge fashion, and that kind of books, they just were sold in super shops, supermarkets. There were special bookshelves. And once I saw this title, just think like billionaire. I mean, here comes a guy with a little bit different title, and it intrigued me a little bit. And actually, I don't remember anything from this book, but one moment one moment was captivating, inspiring in some sense, and let's say I had a moment of weakness. In this book, Trump provided like a list of items, of goods, which should be purchased, used by every decent billionaire. Of course, it includes the Lamborghinis, very fancy names of wine, clothing, and so on. I just even can't spell the name of these brands. But then comes one item, and it was quite surprising one. And you know, actually, it's why I just actually felt a little bit proud, meaning, you know, how is it easy, you know, just to become a billionaire, at least 10% billionaire, 5% billionaire, you know, just to go to the shop and buy this item. And but well, it's all about the power of symbol and so on. It's like, you know, the value of it, it's like very small one, but still, it's at least for a moment you can feel yourself like 5-10% billionaire. But and from this point, I would like to make some very small analogy about, let's say, scientific inquiries and so on. Because in some sense, I've got a feeling that sometimes inquirer scholars are too much captivated by one fixed idea, and they think that their work is oriented, focused on, let's say, uncovering the reality and so on. But it's like in the case of this shampoo, that you think that maybe you're like a 10% or 20% achieving the target, but maybe you're just still at the just chasing the fake ghost. And the problem of one ghost actually is like, and I'm coming again to Hegel and Hegelian framework and so on, but and Fukuyama. But let's start from Westphalian state actually. In terms of Hegel, he used the notion of state as dialectical outcome or reconciliation of family values and civil society values, and it's all about dialectics, dialectical triad. No one of these entities, they can't exist separately, according to him. Fukuyama, just following Hegel, Hegel's interpreter Kojiv, Alexander Kojiv, he introduced that notion of post-historical homogeneous state, meaning that the state without any kind of contradictions. And I just included Wallerstein, just meaning that he was quite, I think, in the right way, critical about that such kind of undeliberate usage of notion of state that even on the unconscious bias level, it still permits all kind of social theories and inquiries. And it's very difficult sometimes just to notice it. And in some sense, it's even if you try to focus to international governance and so on, this the state, it's still present behind your back, Westphalian state. And what is actually, again, I should say, the issue and little problem regarding the method of inquiry? It's not just about that the state as such also, but Hegel actually, he launched very absolutist structure of knowledge, meaning that this idea of absolute knowledge and and in some sense, it created certain difficulties from which actually we can't free ourselves still. Here I want to present you example of a certain approach which, let's say, in case of Fukuyama and his alter ego Kojiv, maybe we, in some sense, I understand that many academics, philosophers, they are skeptical about their work and so on, but what is quite interesting that they introduced and this kind of mode of inquiry and approach to the realities, it still, in some sense, is pervasive. Meaning that what Fukuyama actually is doing, in some sense, and why I find him interesting, but not as an example to follow, that in some sense, he is trying to use this kind of descriptive approach, meaning that he follows the Kojiv's interpretation that we as scholars and inquirers, we don't possess this kind of dialectical method as instrument for research. Dialectics is like a mode of transformation of a reality, so it's already out there, and our just obligation of us scholars just to assume the best position possible and to make the best possible description of that kind of transformation and reality. But who can assure us, is it the right position or is it the right realities and so on? And the idea of this absolute state is in some sense, why is it so strong that the influence of Hegel means that he replaced the idea of Platonic idea as something outside into something more realistic. But well, of course, we don't still have the idea implemented, but maybe it will be implemented in the future. But in order to be like some kind, to be in some sense a realistic idea, it needs to have a definite end of implementation or finalization. And because Hegel's approach is quite systemic one and architectural, meaning that, well, he united all everything in the at the notion of the end of history and in this culmination of the homogeneous state, universal homogeneous state. And Fukuyama used this notion and he implied that the historical evolution of liberal democracy is actually impossible without this idea of homogeneous state. Only in the framework of state, liberal democracy is possible. And just the final slide, and I'm finishing just. Meaning that Fukuyama represents very interesting approach, and that approach very strangely is shifting, and that's why I think that he's a little bit overusing this descriptive approach, that in case of transformations and shifts in historical shifts and events during 10, 20 years, he just slightly can reshape his own theories and so on. And I'm just giving you, let's say, a couple of examples. For example, actually, Trump is quite long-term public figure, I see, in America, that he even managed to get into Fukuyama's book, The End of History, and Fukuyama referred to the case of Trump as example, and expressing the hope that liberal democracy just in the dialectic mood of transformation and evolution, but anyway, liberal democracy, it will manage to secure itself from that kind of figures like Trump, who are just misusing and exploiting the democracy in their own terms, in their own interests. And actually, in another place in this book, Fukuyama just also gives certain interesting approach that maybe, okay, Trump will manage to somehow to channel his own personal urge into some entrepreneurial activities of real estate and so on, but I think we are experiencing very interesting moment, let's say, I should call it like a Trump test in this sense. And just another example, just to show how in some sense it's quite very is perplexed and complicated thing to read Fukuyama and to treat him like a scientist in usual terms, that I'm just giving two papers where are expressed his quite opposing in some sense and different positions that makes him quite controversial in some sense. That, for example, in the paper His History Restarted since September 11, 2002, he's skeptical about this international order because, according to him, international order is not able to sustain democracy, democratic values. Only state as such, it has enough monopoly of power and consolidated power just to secure democracy and liberal values. And he gives example of America's like that kind of state, which is more consolidated, and he reproached European Union as not clear entity of intergovernmental pseudo-federal structure, which is quite complicated one, and probably it has issues to secure liberal values in the same way as US does. But let's say in another article, 12 years later, America and UK, he already criticizes the situation in the United States, claiming that the system of check and balances in US, it's too big, too wide, and for example, it gives too much space for civil society activists and NGOs to influence policy making, like through the courts and so on. And he emphasizes that actually national states of European Union are better in this way, that they provide less wide system of check and balances and allows, you know, to solve that kind of issues in faster way, more efficient way, just in the building of ministries. He is promoting that kind of idea of professional bureaucrat or even like scientific public administrator who are, let's say, very rational people. And let's say, according to him, this kind of international governance is in some sense is unproductive for a liberal democracy. And I think that this kind of topic and issue is still like ongoing one, and it's quite difficult to end the dispute. I mean, for example, just to give an example of very interesting coincidence that I have read a paper by Andrei Kortunov just a couple days ago, and just at the end of that paper, actually, I enjoyed that idea that maybe I'm wrong interpretator again, like Fukuyama, you know, but maybe we are much too focused on the notion of state, and we are forgetting about that last man, Übermensch, or the citizen of this homogeneous state who can arrive just right now immediately without any kind of this state, finalization of state, and maybe he's approaching us already, this self-contained, self-satisfied man without any values. That's all.